Hello and welcome to everyone, Shavua Tov, and especially Yishar Koach to all the women who completed the Hadran's journey to Rosh Hashanah together with me over these past 2 weeks. I hope you had a meaningful and enjoyable journey. Today, to kind of finish up our learning together, we're going to talk about the essence of Rosh Hashanah. What kind of a day is it? Is it a judgment day? Is it a remembrance day? And how can we learn about this essence through looking at the tefillah? We'll do this by looking at two different sugyot, one that we learned in this project and one from a different perek. But before we start, I think we need to start by looking at what the Torah tells us about what this day is. So let's start from the psukim. So the Torah doesn't say very much about Rosh Hashanah. It gives us the date, right? Daber el bnei Yisrael lemor b'chodesh ha-shvi'i b'echad l'chodesh, right, on the seventh month, on the first day, Yelechem Shabbaton Zichron Tru'ah Mikra Kodesh. Now, how to translate Zichron Tru'ah is a little bit tricky because the whole question is, what does it mean, Zichron Tru'ah? Right? It doesn't officially say Shofar, but this is some day of remembrance using or with a loud blast of some sort, and it's Mikra Kodesh, it's Yom Tov. That's what the Torah has to say. And what does Chazal do with this pasuk? We'll see that soon. But for starters, let's go back to something that appears in the first perek of the Masechet. The Mishnah in the first perek of the Masechet discusses b'arba'a parakim ha'olam nidon, right? Four different times of the year, the world is judged. And we have a list of four different dates. B'pesach al ha'tvu'ah, the judgment is passed concerning or regarding grain. Ba'atzeret, during Shavuot, al pirot ha'ilan. Berosh Hashanah, kol ba'ei olam ovrim lefanav kivnei maron, sheneemar, hayotzer yachad libam, hamevin el kol ma'asehem. So on Rosh Hashanah, all creatures pass before Hashem, and he sees all their deeds. And the last one, uvachag, right, meaning Sukkot, b'chag nidonim al ha'mayim, right, we're judged about water, about rain for the next year. Now, just looking at this Mishnah, something which is very obvious is that Rosh Hashanah is different than the other three, right? First of all, we're used to having Pesach, Shavuot, and Sukkot all as one group of Shloshet HaRegalim, right? The three holidays where we're supposed to go to the Mikdash. And besides that, those three have a judgment about something very specific, right? Grain, fruits, water, and all these things are agricultural things, things that help us have enough food to eat over the year. On the other hand, Rosh Hashanah has a more general aspect of judgment, right? Seeing all of our deeds. So that's the first thing I like to say, just looking at this Mishnah. If we keep going in the Gemara, we see the Gemara brings a Braita from the Tosefta. And this Braita kind of explains more in depth where or why these different points of judgment come from. But it's interesting to see that we're not going to actually talk about judgment. Let's notice that in the words of the Braita. Amar Rabbi Yehuda mishum Rabbi Akiva. Mipnei ma amra Torah haviyu omer bepesach, pnei shehapesach zman tvuahu. Amar HaKadosh Baruch Hu haviyu lefanai omer bepesach, kedei shetitbarech lachem tvuah shebasadot. Right, so on Pesach, on Passover, we have the Omer offering. And why is this the appropriate time of year for this offering? Because this is the time of year where grains of harvest, and therefore, if we do this action, that's a way for us to ask Hashem to bless us in that area. And similarly, the Braita explains the same thing about the Korban of Shtei HaLechem, right? The offering of two loaves brought on Shavuot. מפני מה אמרה תורה, הביאו שתי הלחם בעצרת, מפני שעצרת זמן פירות האילן הוא, right? The Shavuot is the time where fruit are beginning to ripen. Therefore, Hashem says, אמר הקדוש ברוך הוא, הביאו לפני שתי הלחם בעצרת, כדי שיתברכו לכם פירות האילן. And we do this action in order to ask Hashem to have blessing in this area of fruit. And similarly, the third chag, מפני מה אמרה תורה, ניסחו מים בחג? אמר הקדוש ברוך הוא, ניסחו לפניי מים בחג, כדי שיתברכו לכם גשמי השנה. Right, on Sukkot, part of the korbanot is pouring water on the altar in the Mikdash. And again, the Braita says, This is a way for us to be asking for bracha, for blessing, in having rainfall during the year. And now, after bringing those three together, right, Pesach, Shavuot, and Sukkot, kind of separately at the end of the Braita, we also discuss Rosh Hashanah, even though chronologically Rosh Hashanah is before Sukkot. Ve'imru lefanai b'Rosh Hashanah malchuyot zichronot v'shofarot. מלכויות כדי שתמליכוני עליכם, זיכרונות כדי שיעלה זיכרונכם לפניי לטובה, ובמה ושופר. So here we have a slightly different idea ending the Braita. The Braita doesn't say what kind of sacrifice or action we should be doing. It's discussing something we need to recite, something we have to say. We should say these verses, these psukim of מלכויות, kingships, and זיכרונות, remembrances, and שופרות. In order to get a different goal, this goal isn't about bracha, but it's supposedly something similar. Malchuyot has a goal of crowning Hashem as a king for us, and Zichronot has a goal of our remembrance rising before Hashem, and the way to make this remembrance rise is with the shofar. Now, it's important to say at this point, with the shofar doesn't mean with the action of blowing the shofar. It means with the reciting of the psukim about shofarot. Okay, so we can add here, in addition to what we saw before in the Mishnah, again we see that Rosh Hashanah is kind of separate than the other three Chagim. We see that the Braita here doesn't use the word of din, of judgment, more talking about bracha, of blessing, of doing things in order for Hashem to bless us in certain areas over those four dates. And we see another difference between Rosh Hashanah and the other three, that the other three are talking about actions that we do in order for Hashem to bless us, where in Rosh Hashanah, the action itself is the recitement, just saying these different psukim. At the next point in the Gemara, they go on to discussing the action itself of blowing the shofar. Now we're leaving the Tanaim and we're looking at the things the Amoraim in the Gemara say. אמר רבי אבאו, למה תוקעים בשופר של איל? It is a well-known question. Why do we blow the horn, the shofar, from a ram of all animals? We've seen in the Gemara that there are other possibilities, but we choose to use an איל, a ram. So why is this? אמר הקדוש ברוך הוא, תקעו לפניי בשופר של איל, כדי שאזכור לכם עקידת יצחק בן אברהם. ומעלה אני עליכם, כאילו עקדתם עצמכם לפניי. So this kind of is an idea that has to do with the remembrances that we mentioned before. Use a shofar from a ram, in order for Hashem to remember Akedat Yitzchak, right, that Abraham was willing to sacrifice his son Yitzchak, and this gives us some sort of merit, some sort of zchuyot before Hashem. Okay, the next drasha talks about why blowing a shofar at all. Amar Rabbi Yitzchak, Lama tokim b'Rosh Hashanah, right, why do we blow the shofar on Rosh Hashanah? And the Gemara says, what? That's a really strange question. Lama tokim b'Rosh Hashanah? Why do we blow? Rachmana amar tiku. The Torah said to blow a shofar. This is a mitzvah from the Torah. What is the question? So they rephrase, Ela lama miri'im. Right? Why do we blow a tru'ah? But again, the Gemara has the same response. Miri'im rachmana amar zichron tru'ah. Right? We have the tru'ah explicitly in the Torah as well. So they try again and rephrase another time. אלא למה תוקים ומריעין כשהם יושבים ותוקים ומריעין כשהם עומדים כדי לערבב השטן. So why do we blow sound the Torah while we're sitting and then blow and sound the Torah again when we're standing? Why do we have תקיעות of the shofar twice? We have the whole set before תפילת עמידה. This is officially called תקיעות of the מיושב, even though it is a common even though in many shuls people stand for this תקיעות, and we have תקיעות again during the Tfilat Amidah, when we're standing. So why do we need both? And they answer, כדי לערבב השטן, to confuse the Satan. What does that mean? כדי לערבב השטן. Let's look at Rashi here. Rashi here says, one second. כדי לערבב, שלא יסטין, right? That he shouldn't have anything bad to say. It's a good explanation. כשישמע ישראל מחבבים את המצוות, מסתתמים דבריו. When he sees how much Israel care for the mitzvot, he'll have nothing else to say, right? His mouth will be closed. It's kind of what they're saying, Rashi explains. Okay, so in other words, if we put these two points together, Before in the Gemara, we were just saying through the Braita that there is a point of zichronot, of bringing up good memories or a good remembrance before Hashem, using the psukim of shofarot. Here we see that the action of the shofar itself also has a role of bringing up our merits to Hashem in two ways. One is using a shofar coming from a ram to remind of Akedat Yitzchak. And the second is to do many more tkiot than needed. Because if the Satan, right, if anyone trying to say bad things or to give a negative judgment of Am Yisrael, will see how much they're trying hard to do even more tkiot shofar than they need to, then they'll have nothing bad to say. There'll be no way for them to pass a negative judgment. And this joins into the whole goal of the shofar being an action done to help in Israel's judgment. Now, before we go on, I'd like to say that we should notice here we haven't talked about judgment, right? We're talking more about zchuyot, about merits, about good remembrance. But later on in these dapim, the Gemara goes heavily into the subject of judgment, of punishments, about Gehenom, okay? About what can someone do to maybe avoid a punishment that they were supposed to get. And I'll give just two examples here of things that are brought up in these dapim, two well-known quotes that appear in these dapim. One, Amar Rabbi Yitzchak, ארבעה דברים מקראים גזר דינו של אדם, ואלו הן צדקה, צעקה, שינוי השם ושינוי מעשה. Right? There are four ways a person's sentence can be torn up. It can be giving charity, tzedakah, crying out to Hashem in prayer, changing one's name, which maybe represents changing who you are, and of course, changing one's deeds. Right? So that's to do with tshuva. Another well-known idea that appears here in these dapim, Amar Rabbi Kosfedai, Amar Rabbi Yochanan, שלושה ספרים נפתחים בראש השנה. There are three books that are opened on ראש השנה. One for the wicked people, right? אחד של רשעים גמורים, אחד של צדיקים גמורים, one for the holy righteous people, ואחד של בינוניים, the people in the middle whose actions are balanced. And then the Rabbi Yochanan goes on to explain that these people here in the middle are kind of an undecided fate between Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur, and every action that they do can determine if they are written for life or for death. So these are both two known ideas, and there are many interesting ideas on these dapim. If you have time, I definitely recommend looking further into dapim Tezayin, Yudzayin, Yudchet, and seeing some of these ideas. But if I'd like to kind of sum up what we see here by looking at the first parak of Rosh Hashanah, we see that Rosh Hashanah is defined as a time of judgment, right? There are four different times where Israel is judged. One of them is Rosh Hashanah. The judgment on Rosh Hashanah isn't a specific area like it is on the other agricultural holidays, rather a more general Hashem looking at all of our deeds. But in some of the sources, right, in the Braita, we saw that it refers to malchuyot, zichronot, and shofarot, but not directly about judgment at all. More about a good remembrance, okay? Also, I'd like to add, we saw, if I go back to 1 second, one point that I missed before, when we saw before in the Braita, malchuyot, zichronot, and shofarot, right? We see that Malchuyot has one goal of making Hashem a king, and Zichronot and Shofarot are related to each other. Okay, so this is an important point to remember for the next part of our Shiur, that there is some sort of separation between Malchuyot and the other two, Zichronot and Shofarot. Right? We use the Shofar to bring up these good remembrances, and Malchuyot has a different role of making Hashem a god. So that's also a point I'd like us to remember while we go on to the next part of our Shiur. And as well, we see that the Gemara, especially in the Amoraim, more than in the Tanaim, relate this subject of bringing up our merits to Hashem, to the idea of judgments, to Hashem making a sentence on what is your year going to look like, and a person can affect this sentence, and etc. Now, we're going to go on to the second half of the Shiur and look at sources from the fourth parak of the Masechet, as opposed to the first parak, which talks more generally about important dates and beginnings and different times of the year. The fourth perek, as we saw, those of us in the journey, talks much more directly about the tefillah of Rosh Hashanah and the tekiot shofar in Rosh Hashanah, and therefore goes much more into detail about malchuyot, zichronot, and shofarot. Now we're going to try to see how maybe we can make some sort of connection between the ideas we saw here regarding a judgment day, regarding how the first perek represents malchuyot, zichronot, and shofarot, between these ideas and between what we'll see in the second perek. Okay, so let's look together at this Mishnah in the fourth perek of the Masechet on Daf Lamed Bet. Seder Brachot Omer Avot Ugvorot Ukdushat Hashem Vekolel Malchuyot Imahem Veino Tokea Kdushat Hayom Vetokea Zichronot Vetokea Shofarot Vetokea Veomer Avoda Vehodaah Uberkat Kohanim Divrei Rabbi Yochanan Ben Uri. So the first opinion in the Mishnah presents us with the order of the brachot in Tfilat Musaf of Rosh Hashanah. Rabbi Yochanan ben Uri says, we start with the almost like the regular first three brachot, right? Starting with Birkat Avot, the patriarchs, Magen Avraham, and then Gvurot, but Hashem is mighty, that's Birkat Mechayi Hamitim, and then the bracha of Kedushat Hashem, right? Sanctification of God's name, says Rabbi Yochanan ben Uri, we add the kingship into this bracha, right? We include it into Birkat Kedushat Hashem. That does not have a tkiat shofar with it. And then we add the special middle brachot for this day, right? Kedushat Hayom, the bracha discussing the special day of Rosh Hashanah, and which has a shofar accompanying it, and Zichronot, followed by the shofar, and Shofarot, right? Followed by the sound of the shofar. And then we end with the regular last three brachot, Avodah, Hoda'ah, and Birkat Kohanim, right? The regular brachot of Modim and Retzeh and Modim and Birkat Kohanim. Okay, so this is the opinion of Rabbi Yochanan ben Uri. Let's see the second opinion and try to notice what are the important differences between the two. Amar lo Rabbi Akiva, im eino tokea lemalchuyot, lama hu mazkir? That if he doesn't blow the shofar, or say malchuyot, then why does he even mention them? Ela omer avot ugvorot ukdushat Hashem. Right, so the first three brachot, avot, gvorot, and kdushat Hashem, we say just the regular way, in the regular order. Vekolel malchuyot im kdushat hayom vetokea, zichronot vetokea, shofarot vetokea, veomer avoda hoda'ah birkat kohanim. So, says Rabbi Akiva, we can include Malchuyot together with the kingships, together with Kedushat Hayom, with this blessing discussing the special day of Rosh Hashanah. And then we follow that with the Shofar. And then we have Zichronot and the blowing of the Shofar, and Shofarot and blowing the Shofar. And then the last three Brachot, like on every day. So let's try to point out a couple things that are really important about this Mishnah. Now, first of all, it's nice to see that both opinions agree that there are kind of three parts to the tefillah, and each part has three brachot, right? This idea of three times three kind of reminds us, especially those of us who learned these dapim over the past week, of the order of the tekiot, is also defined by the Gemara as shalosh, shel shalosh, shalosh, right? We have different sets of three tekiot of each kind. That's a different subject. So we have this kind of using the number three, both in Rabbi Akiva and Rabbi Yochanan ben Uri's opinion. That's one point. Another point, which is a very important one, is that the place of Zichronot and Shofarot is agreed, right? They both put Zichronot and Shofarot, these two special brachot for Rosh Hashanah, in the central part of the tefillah, in the middle. But there is kind of a question mark about where does Malchuyot go? Okay, that's something we're going to talk about more in depth in a minute. Another important point is that they both agree that there is some sort of relationship between whatever special content we add on Rosh Hashanah and the blowing of the shofar, right? It's kind of like a tune and words that go with the tune in a song. So the shofar is like the music, but each blessing is giving different words, different content to that blowing of the shofar. Now that is relevant, I would say, to Rabbi Yochanan ben Uri and to Rabbi Akiva, but Rabbi Akiva says it much more explicitly. He says, if one does not sound the shofar for this blessing of malchuyot, of kingships, why would he even say the malchuyot? So it's clear to Rabbi Akiva that the shofar, the blowing of the shofar, has to go with these three brachot of malchuyot, zichronot, and shofarot. And this makes us have a kind of machloket about where should malchuyot go. Now, this machloket it's not only technical, I would say. It shows us something much deeper about malchuyot, and like we mentioned before, that maybe malchuyot is a little bit different than zichronot and shofarot. But why is it different? Let's look for a second back at the pasuk we talked about before and how Rashi in the Torah explains this pasuk. Right, the sentence or the phrase that we had to explain, to present Rosh Hashanah is Shabbaton Zichron Teruah Mikra Kodesh. And Rashi explains that from the words Zichron Teruah, right, the remembrance of or through a Teruah, it's kind of hard word to, kind of a hard phrase to understand. He says, what is this Zichron? Zichron, Psukei Zichronot V'Psukei Shofarot. He directly learned the idea of saying the psukim, the verses of Zichronot and Shofarot, from this phrase, Zichron Teruah, in the psukim. What about Malchuyot? He doesn't mention Malchuyot at all. Okay, so that's a very important point to notice. Where does Rashi get this idea from? So this drasha, this learning of the pasuk, appears in Chazal, first in the Midrash Halacha of the Sifra, but this Midrash is also quoted in our Gemara, and we'll see the version quoted in our Gemara right here on Daf Lamed Bet. Minayin she'omrim malchuyot, zichronot, v'shofarot. So we have two opinions in the Braita. Where do we learn the order of the brachot from? Let's look only at the main point for us, which is where Rabbi Akiva brings his opinion and explains where it comes from. So he learns from each word something about Rosh Hashanah. Shabbaton, amar lo Rabbi Akiva, Shabbaton, kadeshehu ba'asiyat melacha. Right, from the word Shabbaton, we learn that this is a day where we are prohibited from doing melacha, from doing labor. Zichron, elu zichronot, right, to recite the remembrances. Teruah, elu shofarot, to recite the verses of the shofarot. Mikra kodesh, zok tushat hayom, right, that there is a sanctification of the day, which also is, as we saw, a central part of the tefillah, both according to Rabbi Akiva and according to Rabbi Yochanan ben Nuri, one of the central brachot in the middle of tefillah has to be kedushat hayom, the brachot that discusses the special day that we're on. Okay, but what about malchuyot? In this version of the Braita here in the Gemara, the answer to this comes in a separate Braita, in a separate Tanaic source. Minayin she'omrim malchuyot, right? Where do we learn that one also has to recite this blessing or these verses of kingship? Tanya, Rabbi Omer, Rabbi Yehuda Hanasi says, we learn it from this pasuk, Ani Hashem Eloichem uvechodesh hashvi'i zo malchut. This is a really, really interesting drasha. Where does this pasuk come from? Ani Hashem Eloichem uvechodesh hashvi'i. So first of all, this is not one pasuk. These are two separate pasukim. What Rabbi does here, he says, okay, we have these pasukim that discuss Rosh Hashanah. We can't find malchuyot in this pasukim. Let's see if it's mentioned before. So he goes back to the pasuk before the Torah starts talking about Rosh Hashanah. These are the pasukim that are discussed different holidays in a totally separate paragraph, right? The Torah even has a parashat p'tucha, like a gap in the Sefer Torah between the previous holidays, Pesach and Sfirat HaOmer and Shavuot, and all those holidays end with kind of a summary pasuk, which ends with Ani Hashem Eloichem. And then we go on to HaChodesh HaShvi'i, the holidays of the seventh month, starting with Rosh Hashanah. So what Rebbe does here is very creative, I would say. It is not an obvious midrash at all, saying the malchuyot that we say on, that we recite on Rosh Hashanah, are learned from a pasuk which appears before regarding a different holiday. That is a very interesting thing. Second thing, which you might have noticed, that the pasuk Ani Hashem Eloichem does not include the word Melech or Melucha, right? It doesn't include kingship explicitly at all. This writer has a second opinion as well. Rabbi Yosei bar Rabbi Yehuda Omer, Eino Tzarich, right? We don't need to go back and look at the psukim before Rosh Hashanah because we have a different source. Harei hu Omer, V'hayu lachem lezikaron lifnei Elohichem. This is the pasuk from the perek in Chumash Bamidbar, where the Torah discusses the blowing of the trumpets, both in the desert of Sinai, and in the future at times of happiness and at times of war. And these psukim end with a pasuk, והיו לכם לזיכרון לפני אלוהיכם, אני השם אלוהיכם. So the way Rabbi Yosei bar Rabbi Yehuda learns these psukim, he says, okay, it says, והיו לכם לזיכרון לפני אלוהיכם. שאין תלמוד לומר, אני השם אלוהיכם. There's no need to also add, אני השם אלוהיכם, right? I am your God. מה תלמוד לומר, אני השם אלוהיכם? What do we learn from adding this phrase, אני השם אלוהיכם? זה בנאב, right? This is like a place, a source we can learn from to other places as well. לכל מקום שנאמר בו זיכרונות, יהיו מלכויות עמהם. Any place that discusses remembrance, zichronot, right, like in the pasuk, vayu lachem lezikaron, this automatically goes with kingship, with malchuyot. And again, similar to what happened with Rebbe just before, the pasuk does not actually say king in any way, but it says, ani Hashem Elohechem, right, I am the Lord your God, which is in a way some sort of declaration, which is similar in these Tanaim's opinion to kingship. Right? An interesting point to mention about this pasuk that Rabbi Yosei bar Rabbi Yehuda brings is that these are again psukim that have together tkiah, in this case not of a shofar, but of the trumpets, but the tkiot go with zikaron, right? We blow these trumpets with a goal of a zikaron before Hashem, of remembrance, of Hashem remembering us. And Chazal kind of add in to these zikaron and shofar that are already close together, Chazal kind of add, in a slightly less natural way, I would say, add in the malchuyot as well, even though it's not obvious that they're there, okay? So we can just, if I'll just explain what we saw here, we had the pasuk, Shabbaton Zichron Teruah, Mikra Kodesh. We saw that Zichron Teruah teaches us about saying, reciting Zichronot and Shofarot and Rosh Hashanah. And we see the Tanaim looking for a source that Malchuyot is also part of this group. That the group is not just the pair, which we find often together of Zikaron and blowing a Shofar, memory and Shofar together, but Malchuyot is also part of it. It's a trio, not a pair. But it is obvious that they're kind of divided. It's the two of them and the Malchuyot, which we try to add in and connect it in different ways. Okay, now we see here in these psukim, as we said, that there isn't actually the word melech in psukim that are brought as a source for the idea of kingship, right? They're both psukim that say, ani Hashem Elohim, using the word Elohim, right? Being your God instead of, or as a kind of a substitute for official kingship, for using the word king explicitly. I think probably remember, and we'll look at it together, that this problem or this idea, this substitute, comes up in another place in this perek as well. And here we're going to the next page in the Gemara, Daf Lamed Bet Amud Bet. And the Brakta here talks about a halakha, Vatikim hayu mashlimim otah b'torah. Okay, so this Brakta is discussing how many psukim we should say for each part, for Malchuyot, for Zichronot, and for Shofarot. And the Mishnah said, or the Gemara discusses it further, but let's just summarize it up. We say three psukim from each part, Torah, Nevi'im, and Ketuvim, each part of the Tanakh, and we learn that it's good to finish it, right, Lashlim, to add up to 10 by ending with pasuk from the Torah. So you want to have 10 psukim in total for each part, three from the Torah, three from both Nevi'im and Ketuvim, and then the 10th one, a final one from the Torah to get to 10 psukim. So the Gemara says, okay, Bishlema Zichronot veShofarot, right, granted, we can conclude Zichronot and Shofarot with psukim with a verse from the Torah, Ikatuva, because there are many psukim that can fit what we need. Ela Malchuyot, but for kingships, we have a problem. Tlatu Dehavayan, we only have in the Torah, in the whole Torah, three psukim that discuss Hashem as a melech. And the Gemara brings the three psukim that we have. Hashem Elohav imo utruat melech bo. This pasuk comes from the speech of Bilam. Vayhi bishurun melech, which comes from the Zot HaBaracha at the end of the Torah. And Hashem Yimnoch Leolam Va'ed, which appears, of course, at the end of Shirat Hayam after crossing the Dead Sea. And those are the only three places that we have a melech as Hashem, as a Melech, of course, mentioned explicitly in the Torah. And if we want to use this opinion, this Braita, we don't have enough psukim. What are we going to do? Right? We need 10 and we don't have. Amar Rav Huna, so Rav Huna says here, we can find a solution from different Tanakh sources. Tashma, Shema Yisrael, Hashem Elokeinu, Hashem Echad, Malchut. This pasuk, right, the declaration of Shema Yisrael, declaring Hashem as a God, is Malchut. This is kingship. This is the opinion of Rabbi Yossi. Rabbi Yehuda disagrees and he says, no, Eino Malchut. That's not considered a kingship. And the same machloket again. V'yadata'a yom v'ashevot elev avecha, ki Hashem hu ha'elohim e'od. So again, Rabbi Yossi says, this is another pasuk, right? Hashem being the God, this is another pasuk of Malchut, and Rabbi Yehuda again disagrees and says, Eina Malchut. And Ata horet al hadat, ki Hashem hu ha'elohim ein od milvado, Malchut. Divrei Rabbi Yossi, Rabbi Yehuda omer, Eina Malchut. Right? The third pasuk, which Rabbi Yossi brings, also has Hashem hu ha'elohim, right? A declaration of Hashem as God. And again, Rabbi Yehuda says, this is not Malchut. Okay, so what do we see here? And what can this maybe add to the larger picture that we're trying to find here in the sugiyot? We see that it's not common for the Torah to describe Hashem as a melech. A possible reason why this is the case is that a king, as an example of a big power, right? A king who controls a large area and can affect what will happen to every person in this empire, isn't so much the reality known in the Torah. In Mitzrayim, yes. In Egypt, yes. Right? Maybe that's why Yitzhak Mitzrayim has such a religious aspect of the whole, you know, Paro thinking he's God and all that story. But that will be a shiur for Pesach. We're not going to go into that now. But most of the kings in the Torah are kind of more local kings, right? You can be a king, you can be a leader of a specific city. But a king as someone who kind of runs and decides everything for an entire empire is not so common in the Torah, which is maybe why we can't find enough psukim for Hashem as a king, because this isn't the best metaphor, or it isn't the most common metaphor in the Torah, because it's not so relevant at the time. On the other hand, during the time of the rabbis of the Mishnah and later, this is a much more relevant metaphor. They live in the Roman Empire, and they see this king who rules what they think is almost the entire world and can decide everything and kind of sees themselves in a way as a god. Okay, so that's much more an idea relevant to the Chachamim of the Mishnah, which is maybe part of the reason that Malchuyot, even though it's not so clear from the Psukim, it's not, you know, officially there with a Zichron Torah, maybe that's part of the reason that Chachamim see it as an important, I would say, language to use within our tefillah of Rosh Hashanah. So let's just try to kind of add up all together the different things that we saw over this shiur, okay? So in the first part of the shiur, we talked about Rosh Hashanah as a judgment day, right? And we saw that this judgment of Rosh Hashanah is a little different than the judgment of the agricultural holidays, where it's a very specific judgment. It's being more general. We saw that the Braita connects Rosh Hashanah and its judgment to not the action, but the action of reciting psukim for Malchuyot, Zichronot, and Shofarot. And within that, we saw that Malchuyot is a little bit different than the others. The idea of Rosh Hashanah as a judgment day, in a more kind of frightening sense, is developed further on in these Dapim and the Gemara, and we saw a few examples for that, but that's not necessarily the tone, the main idea, or the main feeling of the first sources, especially the Tanakh sources, such as the Braita that we saw. In the second part of the shiur, we saw that there's machloket about how to build Tfilat Amidah, and especially where should Malchuyot go. Is Malchuyot part of the kind of introduction to Tfilah, together with saying Ata Kadosh? We discuss Hashem also as being a king, and that's kind of the introduction to explain why we're saying whatever we're saying in the rest of Tfilah. Or, as the opinion of Rabbi Akiva is Malchuyot added as part of the central core of this trio, Malchuyot, Zichronot, and Shofarot, even though that connection is not so clear from the Torah. Okay, so what should we do with this understanding? Well, how can this maybe affect or give us some thought in what we should think about in our tefillah? And how do we treat Yom Hadin? And what is the different tone of zichronot, of malchuyot, of shofarot? I think when we talk about the judgment day, and this appears in our tefillah, thinking about kings like in the Roman Empire, this is a very frightening kind of judgment, right? And we have this in our tefillah, especially in some very well-known piyutim, what will happen this year and will be written for life or for death. But if we kind of go back more to the basics and we remember the first before trio, the first pair we have of zichronot and shofarot, and using the shofar not for judgment, but for, as the Braita said, to bring up your zikaron letovah, right? To bring up good memories and good remembrances of Am Yisrael, using the action of the shofar to remind the Kadosh Baruch Hu of our zchuyot, of our merits from our actions and from our patriarch's actions. It's kind of, I would say, a different tone. And maybe even Malchuyot itself, which has decided it should be part of the tefillah, it itself doesn't only have to be a frightening kind of king, like in the Roman Empire, but also a king who knows us well, who is close to us, who can remember our good deeds as well, and make the Yom Hamlachat Hashem, right, be the Malchuyot of this day, also be a kind of a celebration, and not only, I would say, the frightening kind of judgment day that we're used to thinking about. So I hope these sources kind of gave you some new food for thought for our tefillah for Rosh Hashanah this year. And again, I would like to say kol hakavod to all the women who learned these dapim with us together over the past 2 weeks in this Hadran's journey to Rosh Hashanah. And Bezrat Hashem, Ktiva v'chatima tova, may Hashem bless us with, have good memories of us, and bless us with a good year of Besorot Tovot, good news, Yeshuot v'nechamot. Shana tova.